Bidding gracious, Lord, as your presence dwells among your children throughout the ages, so abide with us now. Open our hearts and our eyes to see you in new and powerful ways. Allow your spirit to uplift each of us. Amen. The gospel that we'll hear for today is a very powerful gospel, but it's one in which I believe we've lost the sense and the purpose of where this was placed in Jesus' larger ministry. I'd like you to think about a moment about our friend St. Peter. Now, Peter, 3 years earlier, was out fishing on a lake, and this itinerant preacher came and preached a story to him. But that story that Jesus preached to Peter was so powerful that it absolutely touched his heart and transformed the way in which Peter would live his life. And so when this itinerant preacher said, "Peter, come with me, and you will no longer be catching fish, but you will be a fisher of men," Peter joyfully left all that he had, his family, his friends, his boat, his livelihood, to follow Jesus. And over the course of 3 years, Peter saw with his very own eyes Jesus touch the hearts of thousands of people. He saw with his very own eyes as Jesus fed hungry people by the thousands with an abundance of food. He saw with his very own eyes Jesus lay his hands on people who had been sick or ill or blind or deaf or lame and suddenly, miraculously be healed by this man's touch. Peter saw with his own eyes even a young girl who had died, thought to have died, and Jesus go into her chamber and raise her from death. Peter saw with his own eyes Jesus standing on the hill, and the power of God came among him, and he lit up like this beautiful light bulb and was filled with energy from the Holy Spirit. And in that moment, Peter knew that he was the Son of God. Even though Jesus had told Peter and his other friends several times over the course of their time together that the time would come that he would be handed over and crucified on the cross, Peter couldn't believe it. This man who was filled with such power from God could never die. This man who brought hope to people who had lost hope in the world could never leave. And so the words that Jesus spoke were words that fell deftly on Peter's ears, because in his heart he knew that Jesus had the power within him to transform the world around him. Jesus would lead God's children to a glorious life. This was validated by the events of Palm Sunday, as Jesus walks into Jerusalem and thousands of people strew their palm branches and garments along the road to welcome him into the holy city. And over the course of the next 4 days, Jesus is seen preaching and teaching in the temple, and now comes the Sabbath meal. As they enter into that chamber to have the Sabbath meal together, Jesus feels different to Peter. Jesus is the same, but something is different. As they enter into the room, Jesus bows and bends and washes their feet. Something is different. Jesus shares anew with his disciples that he's about to be handed over, and that one of them will perpetrate that activity. Something is different. Jesus begins giving teachings to his disciples about what life without Jesus among them looks like, what this all means. Now it's Thursday evening. The disciples and Jesus participate in the Sabbath meal, for the Sabbath began at sundown, and Jesus offers the following words. Will those who are able please rise now for the gospel? Jesus said, "I am the true vine, My Father is the vine grower. He removes every branch in me that bears no fruit. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes to make it bear more fruit. You have already been cleansed by the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me as I abide in you. Just as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine. You are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me you can do nothing. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Such branches are gathered, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples. The Gospel.
Praise be to
the Lord Christ. You may be seated. As our message continues, our ushers will begin passing green yarn to each of you, symbolic of the vine that Jesus just spoke about. As the vine comes to you, I'd ask that you please wrap it around one of your wrists three times and pass the vine to the person sitting closest to you. When at the end, all of us should be connected to the very vine which was pruned for all of us on Good Friday. You know, one look at the world in which we live tells us that this world that we live in is one that is still filled with a great deal of hate and sinfulness. We can turn on our televisions this week and see the events unfolding before our eyes in Baltimore, and regardless of what we think about how people reacted, we can know within our hearts that prejudice and hatred is still alive and well within our country. We need look no farther than the events of Nepal to see how strongly the forces of nature can impact the human frailty of the human life. Or you and I need look no farther than our local hospitals, our local doctor's office, and our local morgues to see how sin and chronic illness continues to plague humanity. And yet, amid all of these uncertainties in life, amid all of the stress and the anxiety that our life can bring, Jesus promises you and I, just like he did those disciples gathered in the upper room, that our Lord will never abandon us. Notice how Jesus doesn't say in the Gospel of John, "You must abide in me." Rather, Jesus says, "I abide within you." No matter what our life brings our way, God, through Jesus, continues to abide with us today. God is not that absentee landlord who just sees the problems that plague the world and walks away with a deaf ear. No, the God that you and I worship is a God where that vine that was pruned was the actual life of God's only Son, Jesus Christ, and that vine began to grow from the crucifix or the cross of Jesus outside of Jerusalem. We cannot nor will not worship and glorify a God that simply brought about the resurrection and the glorious empty cross without understanding fully and completely that our God is tied to our own suffering through the very cross in which he bore pain and took on the worldly sin in order to bring new life to the world. The very vine which Jesus talks about as being the true vine is the vine that was pruned on Good Friday, the vine of Jesus. And through that pruning, God brings about new life into the world and allows us to have a sense of hope and purpose within our days. God, through Jesus, continues to walk with us through our times of suffering and trial, but will bring all of our experiences to a good end in God's own time. This is never to say or to minimize that things happen within this world for a good or godly reason. Rather, it is to say that in spite of the evil which plagues our land, in spite of the disease which plagues our body, even in spite of mortal death, our God's word will have the final word. As we are pruned, opportunities for new life emerge. As we are pruned, other vines are grafted into our life that may enrich our worldly experiences. As we are pruned, God still clings to us like a vine to a tree, like a vine that will never, ever go away. The cross demonstrates God's commitment to love us beyond any human measure, because through the cross of Jesus Christ, we see our God wrestling with the sin and evil that plagues humanity. And just when it appears that that sin and evil may have won the day, as the Son of God hangs on the cross, our Lord triumphantly becomes the victor of even death and says, none of this will have the final word. Our Lord came into this world never to condemn or to judge, but rather to bring new life and new hope and love to each of God's children. Regardless of our life situations, if we lose our job, if our income isn't what we want and our bills keep climbing, God clings to us and will never abandon us. If we or someone we love is sick or comes chronically ill, our God will never abandon us. Our God will stay with us. And even when we experience the mortal loss of life of people that we know and love, our God hangs on to us like this vine, promising us new life and new hope and a better tomorrow in God's reign. God gives you and I not only God's love, but all of these branches to walk with us in our worldly pilgrimage here on earth. God says when you're going through a difficult time, another branch will be there to uplift you, support you, and love you. It's just one more way in which God's love stays on us and stains our very body with its beautiful essence. So indeed, each one of us gathered within this holy place will go through times of pruning in our life. We will each, in our own and unique and powerful ways, experience times and moments and seasons of great hardship. But our God promises, through this very vine that now circulates throughout our holy space, that our God will always abide with us and cling with us and cherish others to join in our journey. The hardships that you and I face will never, ever have the last word. sin and evil might be present in the world around us, but it will never prevail against the love of God. You and I are blessed by the very mind that ties us all together. Amen. And now,